everybody, now to a short course on provenance for simulation study. You all heard from Andre about the ODD protocol and how you are reporting your results and how you're reporting what you did, more or less in these kind of documentation standard. And of course, it provides a certain kind of structure. However, you do not get a really easy overview about the development process, and also it is not represented in a computer queryable or accessible format. So at the end of the day, if you're doing this, so you have a nice simulation model developed, as for example our cooperation partners from the Max Planck Institute of Rostock did, and then you're writing a paper, and then you are then starting to document this model with the help of like a ODD report and also reports referring to the inputs that you use. At the end of the day, you have a lot of papers that you need to sift through, so to get to the information you are interested. And the question is, of course, can we do better? And simulation studies are, of course, really intricate processes, similarly like to maybe not as complicated as migration processes, but nevertheless you have a lot of data that you have to collect, you have hypotheses, you have theories, and you have to put everything together into your model. And this kind of process, of course, can also be subject to modeling, so to better kind of understand what you did. And here, what you did or how a simulation model came into being, this information we typically call provenance, or as it is stated here, so it is information about entities, activities, and people involved in producing a piece of data or thing which can be used to form assessments about its quality, reliability, or trustworthiness. So that is what we would like to have. Because, of course, we want to have trust in our models, in our simulation models, and we want to do so, as said, in a structured, computer accessible manner. So what we then use here is PROV. PROV is a standard to describe provenance. Actually, it has not been developed to help us deal with our simulation studies, but it is a rather broad area of research in databases and reproducible science. So PROV is a standard, and to describe provenance information as an annotated causality graph. So we have a graph which nodes and edges, and we have entities, as the nodes are the products, the inputs in our simulation studies, and activities, so actions performed on or caused by entities resulting in new entities. And typically what connects the relations between entities and activities are that an activity uses an entity. It may use it in different kind of roles, like for example our simulation study, as in a kind of like when you are doing the you're using data for calibration, you're using data for validation. And we have entities that are generated by these activity, for example, that you have now received or that you achieved a validated simulation model. So the idea back to as is now to apply this kind of, yeah, more structured or more computer accessible way of describing what we did with our migration model. So we are back in our migration study, not ours, but of my colleagues at the Max Planck Institute. And we went through the ODD definition that they did and more or less took these things apart. And what you see here, as said, is you have an activity, and created by this activity is a migration model. So this on the right side is more or less the time flows from the left to the right. And what you see here is at the right side, the result is a migration model. The activity is you're composing the model from different kind of processes. And you find here a lot of different processes that I wanted to go into detail here. But what you see is that income is obviously a something which is modeled here explicitly. Also, what you're consuming as a result of your daily life. Then halt, whether you are marrying, also marriage processes, fertility processes, all these processes you typically expect in these kind of models. Then there exist also costs, and these costs here are the costs that are induced due to your wish to migrate. And you have, of course, a certain kind of mortality, and then the decisions that, again, has to kind of like this decision model that all come together to form now the migration model. This kind of like here, the decision here at that point, one moment, the decision here is of course depending on the theory of planned behavior and takes of course into account everything what else is currently the state of our agent. But nevertheless, let's look a little bit more in more concretely how these things are put together, or how we develop these kind of provenance model of what has happened here. So we are starting with the birth. So this is a fertility, yeah, where in the ODD document there is a lot of description how these fertility model is supposed, what it should cover. Then when we are looking more closely, it's dependent on the Hedwiger model for age-dependent fertility. Some of you might know that. And of course, on certain kind of data. In this kind, this here is the data of Zimbabwe. And these are now, then what you're doing is that you are now fitting this kind of the Hedwiger model to, depending on these kind of data, so to achieve a fertility model. But you want also to know a little bit about the fertility of the people living in France, and for that you are, as of the people who migrated to France, and therefore you use a different kind of data set that is based on interviews, the MAVE data set, and again you are fitting it. So your fertility model at the end of the day consists of two things. Then the fertility is determined depending on whether you are currently in the Senegal or you are in France, based on the data there, and together then on the basis of the Hedwiger model. Okay, but as I just said, this fitting, the fitting is described rather extensively here. And fitting, of course, is a kind of simulation experiment that you are conducting with your simulation model. And to have a little bit more information about that, actually, that they used are kind of certain kind of fitting procedure that you are getting out of this graph. So we are getting into that. So we have now, when you're looking here, you have here now a migration model, and the first fitting is referring to the gender, and out of this falls a specification of the simulation experiment. So this here is a specification of the simulation experiment that you can rerun depending on how you encoded it, maybe as a Python code, maybe as an R script, or maybe as a specific language, like for example, Cecil. And you have then a certain kind of model. And again, this model is subject to a further fitting to an age distribution down here. And you're getting out of this a calibrated model and the age experiment here. And then at the end of the day, you are doing certain kind of experiments here, the scenario experiment. And those will then produce the predictions that are then shown in the figures in your paper. So that is more or less how you can see how these provenance graphs gives you detailed information about what you did. And the good thing about that, if you have this as a provenance graph, of course, then you can query it. Yeah, but first of all, how does this provenance graph is different from the typical provenance information? As said, we are using a standard for provenance which has not been defined for simulation studies. But we are adapting it simply by saying, okay, what do you need if you want to describe a simulation study? As entities, you have possibly requirements, assumptions, qualitative models, a simulation model, simulation experiment, data or theory. You can think of other things as well, but maybe that is a good point to start. The activities that you have are building simulation model, possibly calibrating, validating simulation model, analyzing it. You can have also statistical fitting if you want to have also look a little bit how you're working with the data. The roles are referring when you're using in your activities, you're using data, for example, for calibration, validation. You're using simulation models possibly also for cross-validation. So you can think about these things. And if you have now this kind of information, then you can put this in a database, preferably a graph database, and then you can, for example, ask things like, okay, if the data are invalidated, which products of my simulation study need to be revisited? So where could I possibly assume that a data set becoming invalid, what kind of products of my simulation study become invalid as well? And you see here that there are certain kind of data that I derived here and these certain kind of processes. Yeah, certain kind of models that I did. You see here, these are the experiments, the simulation experiments defined. All of those have to be checked again. You can, because of course these graphs tend to become rather large, and maybe to have a better overview can of course do these kind of that you're thinking about hierarchies or that you have a modular approach so that, for example, here, the activity A4 is an activity that again is composed of the different kind of activities using different kind of real data here with W3 or W indicated and certain kind of models. And then you are then again here, for example, A4 is again a composed activity, so you can zoom in as you then would like to do. Okay? So, and when you have then very, very large provenance graphs, this is a small one that is really a toy example, but it has already more than 70 nodes and 119 edges. What you then can do is, of course, query all input data used in the last model version, for example, and then you're getting the different kind of here parameter values out of that and then where they are coming from, or building and validating phases, no, only to show those, or bird's eye view on the final results of the simulation study, only the last versions of entities are shown. And you see here that it was really a very simple simulation study. It was a toy of a predator prey. And we used only two publications here to build first a conceptual model, then come up with a kind of requirement, and then this kind of requirement to show that it really the simulation model had then to adhere to this kind of behavioral requirements, which you can state, for example, in terms of data, so the data should be reproduced, or for example, that you're saying, okay, you would like to see a peak of that height at a certain time, things like that. Okay. What you can also do if you have now provenance about one simulation model, how you build one simulation model, or here, how you build one simulation model, you can then relate it to other simulation models that you base your simulation model on. For example, if you're thinking about here, this kind of here, down here, one moment, I have to check. This is not easy. So down here, somehow this is, this here. So you're using different kind of data here. And then what you see here, you are using also other simulation, as you are referring to other simulation studies, reusing, for example, models or yeah, part of the models or cross-validating your simulation model with other models. And because you know what these kind of models have been built based upon, you can assess whether this reuse of simulation model is, for example, valid for the questions and the data you have. And you can even go beyond simulation studies, actually, that we are doing, or we did in our BABS project that Jakub Bicak is the head of. So here what we used here you see in the beginning the different kind of iteration of the different types of simulation models that we developed. And you see at the end, at here, this point here, this really uses data that have been cleaned up and that have been somehow modified during these kind of processes here, which part of the project is responsible for. And they have been enriched by results from psychological experiments that another part of the project did. So at the end of the day, this kind of approach allows you a kind of, yeah, really to keep on top of what you're doing during your project, particularly if you have a project where you are developing simulation models, halt, yeah, in different versions, of course, of them, maybe different simulation models. You have to deal with data and here in this case also with real experiments. Of course, some kind of software support is important. As I said, when you want to do that, you have a database and preferable one, a graph-based database like Neo4j is very, makes sense. And this is kind of like an user interface for the web we developed. And that was Kai Budde and a student from the University of New Brunswick in Canada. And where you then can add in some of these information, but it's still a research prototype, I have to admit. So, Prof. Onertürich for modeling and simulation studies, what have we gained? It's a structured approach and an accessible approach to conduct simulation studies. Accessible, first of all, from the point of view that you can more easily see what the structure is and how things have evolved. Yeah, so it's an essential ingredient, I have to admit, is here to making also the simulation experiment explicit. That is very important because the simulation experiments are typically the point where you are getting the simulation model and the data together, for example, for fitting or also for validating. So to have those explicitly described, and better not in text, but really in terms of, for example, the script and so forth. Of course, you can annotate it, but nevertheless, that should be also part of that. And this kind of information, it grows, of course, depending on the complexity of your endeavor. Then you can have them accessible for filtering, analyzing, and querying. And for example, are the same data used for calibration or validation? These are queries that you would like to ask. And it's really interesting, particularly if you're building simulation families, or model families, for example, about migrations. Yeah, so then you are referring to other migration studies, and then you can think about this then that you have really a network of information. Yeah, so the usefulness so far of our approach has been demonstrated in several simulation studies, cell biology, ecology, and demography. And we have to say it really kind of like all modeling efforts, it really structures the knowledge and it really structures the process in which you are conducting a simulation study. However, what we should say is this is really a research prototype. So also the software, you're welcome to try it out a little bit, but it's nothing that we can really support you because we are at the university. So, but nevertheless, so there is a little bit of support. But I would really like to encourage you to try it out because it's really, it helps you a lot to get some structure in what you did, what kind of data you use for what kind of purposes. But it is still ongoing research. And so whereas ODD is an established standard, at the end of the day, of course, we want to bring everything together. And for now, I'm looking forward to your questions and thank you for the attention.